So we are here today with Chris McDonald with this really cool 1923 tea bucket. So Chris, what is it that interests you the most about these cars?
Hey, thanks for asking. These cars are really kind of crazy. A lot of history on them. You know, it goes back to Henry Ford and the actual Model T. The Model T came in a variety of different formats back in the 1920s and whatnot. And they built a whole lot of them. And over the years, as time went on, people started finding these Model Ts and modifying them for racing, for hot rods. They really are the original hot rod. What's so cool about them is anybody could get their hands on one, put it together out of bits and pieces, and because they're so light, they go fast no matter what you got in the front of it. And as years went on as well, Ford came out with a flathead V8, and it was real easy to go find flathead V8s in the junkyards out of other Fords. You could put them in these. Again, take the fenders off, take the running boards off, configure it the way that you wanted, and you had an instant hot rod. Because a car like this probably weighs about, you know, 1800 pounds, and that makes a lot of performance. And actually, these cars are a big part of American history. Not only are they really the original American hot rod, but back in the 1950s, there was a television show that featured one of these in it, and that really caused the American public to become aware of what these hot rods were. So they're a real piece of Americana. They're not for everybody, but I really like them. They're really cool.
Oh, some cool history about it. So where did you get it?
So this one has a long story, and I'm not going to bore everybody with the incredibly long story. Short to say that my family bought this thing somewhere in the early 1980s. It was actually a drug-seized vehicle in the state of Florida. It was involved in some kind of drug dealer action or what have you. State of Florida had taken it and put it up for auction. My dad bought it. And I remember when I was a kid, you know, I was 10, 11 years old, and I remember the whole family kind of coming together and polishing on the chrome and trying to get everything back running because it had been sitting for a while. So some of my earliest memories of doing car stuff or doing family car stuff was right here wrapped up in this machine.
That's pretty cool memories for this car and place you got from it. So what kind of modifications were added to this?
So this car has had a variety of different modifications. We don't know who built it prior to my dad buying it. We have no idea. I can tell you some things about it. We do know that the engine and transmission are from a 1967 Nova. The engine originally was a 327. It has a turbo 400 transmission, and it just has an open 10-bolt rear axle on it with drum brakes in the rear. So back in the day when we originally got this, it had the big drum brakes on the front. Very hard to stop, very hard to operate. It also had the original points and condenser set up in it, so every so often you'd have to clean the points and you'd have to adjust the timing. It used to have an electric fuel pump in it, and I remember when I was a kid, it was really noisy and it would groan and grunt back here, and you could almost hear it louder than you could hear the engine. So, like I said, it's a long story. From the time that we originally had it, it actually went out of the family and it came back into the family at a later date. And around 2004, we started working on it again, and the whole family pitched in to help out. So family members that couldn't do things immediately, some of them bought parts for it, others came over and worked on it. And we actually took it and stripped it completely down and repainted it the same color it was back from when we first got it, this crazy bowling ball metallic orange. My mom had an upholstery shop redo the seats in it. We took the instrument panel out and kind of went through it, cleaned it up. It now has some bigger speakers in it, and it also has a modern style radio with a remote. On the front end, the brakes were just awful. So I had some spare parts here and there, and I actually ended up putting some front brake calipers on it off of a 1985 Corvette. So it now has a disc brake, and what's really freaky about that is those sort of brakes were made to fit underneath a 16-inch rim in a 1985 Corvette, and this has 14-inch rims on it. And so they fit, but it's just crazy close. And that's what hot rodding's about. And that's the other thing about T-buckets is you'll never find two the same, because you can do all sorts of things to these, whatever makes sense, whatever you like to do.
So could you tell me a bit more about the engine?
Sure. So like I said earlier, this is a 327 out of a 67 Nova. And in 2004, when I went back to start rebuilding it, I had a couple concerns about the drivability of the car. It had a bit of a cam in it. It was a little bit rough to kind of get in and get going. And plus the 1967 cylinder heads that were here required a lead additive with the new fuels to make sure that everything stayed proper. And I actually put a set of cylinder heads on here off of a late 80s Chevrolet pickup truck, as well as a regular truck or RV cam. And it actually made the car a lot more drivable, a lot more usable, because I can operate now in a really low RPM band, nice and easy for kind of cruising and around the neighborhood. Engine, other than that, is a real stock style 67. It has the old oil filter on it that actually has the canister inside of it when you change it. And the carburetor on it is a later model than the engine, Holley, with a nice electric choke, which is great for cold weather. And as you can see, we're starting to get some cold weather right now. Not a good car for cold weather anyway, but it's nice to have an electric choke and modern features. Also on the distributor, this kit that I put in here completely replaces the old point system. So now it has a module that's mounted up inside the firewall here, and it acts as the trigger for the ignition system. Anybody out there that's ever messed with points or an old car, you don't have to do that anymore. So those are really, really not a whole lot. One other thing, I had mentioned, I believe it had an electric fuel pump that was noisy way back when. I learned something. When I switched over to a regular fuel pump on here, I just put a fuel pump like for a, you know, a 67 Nova, whatever, on it. And I kept driving the car. Whenever I would park it, it would fill the carburetor full of fuel. It would flood just sitting in the garage every time you turn it off. And what was happening is the gas tank sits higher than the carburetor, and with the fuel pump that was on it, the gas would come in and gravity would push it right past everything and really goof me up whenever the car was left sitting. And I found out later the problem was I needed to have the fuel pump with the return line on it. And so anyone out there that's had any flooding issues or after run issues on something like this, believe it or not, the fuel pump can be the problem. So this pump has the return line that goes back, it's teed back into it. No more flooding issues. But that's really pretty much it. There's just not much to tell. It's about as simple can be. You can run 87 octane in here. You can run anything you want to run. And this thing just runs on it all day long, nice and quiet.
Thanks for having an interview today. That was pretty cool information about this vehicle.
Oh, you know something I forgot?
What's that?
You asked me about memories. You asked me about the car. There was a favorite memory I had about this car. It's kind of frightening, but it was a favorite memory. The shifter in it used to come all the way up and sit against the seat, the automatic shifter. And it was really worn out and sloppy. And if you bounced on the seat too hard, you could actually cause the shifter to move out of place on the transmission. So back when I was a kid, my dad was taking a neighbor for a ride in it. They went up to the gas station. And as they were getting ready to leave, one of them bounced on the seat. He was accelerating and it threw it into reverse. And of course, when it threw it into reverse, they went forward in it and put my dad on the throttle, and he lit the tires up going backwards. And so it took him for a few moments to get his foot off the throttle. And this thing went backwards for, I don't know, it seemed like a mile, but it shot backwards down the road, smoking the tire and scaring everybody to death before we could get it to a stop. And I can tell you, on the modifications, I got rid of that shifter. And now it has a good shifter with a lockout in it to keep that from ever happening again. So do you want to take it for a ride?
Of course I do.
All right, let me get you where you can. So first thing is, obviously you got to get in.
Where's the doors?
Good question. There are no doors. As a matter of fact, back in the original T-buckets back in the day, this was not a door anyway. You always had to get in from this side. So now you got to show me how you get in without a door.
All right, well, there's a pipe down here. Is it hot?
Those pipes get extremely hot and they can burn people. So you want to be careful, especially in shorts. Don't touch the pipe.
All right, got it. Now if I step on the tire and sit on the seat, am I gonna damage it at all?
No, just step on the tire, kind of step on the seat, and hop in, and you'll be all set.
All right. So, now what?
All right, so on this car, you'll notice you don't have a whole lot for pedals down here. And you always want to make sure you got that brake covered, okay?
Okay.
And unlike a lot of cars with an automatic transmission, you're going to two-pedal this one just to be safe because of where the pedals are. You notice there's not a lot of room between them, okay? That way you can keep them covered. Your starting switch is right here with your key. This has a lockout on the transmission. You'll notice you can't pull it just straight back into gear. You have to lift up on the handle, and then you can bump it back.
Got okay? it.
And when you go forward, you bump it forward, lift up on the handle, and in a drag racing car, that keeps you from knocking it into reverse or whatever, going down the highway, kind of like what happened to it a long time ago. Okay?
Good feature.
All right, go ahead and start it up. Give it a little gas to your right foot.
Pretty fun.
You ever driven anything like that before?
No, I have not.
Pretty cool. Well, now you've been in a piece of history.
I gotta say something though.
Okay.
Not much steering and not much brake.
Not much steering or brake, that's true. But how is it on the cool factor?
Really cool.
All right.
So, hey, how practical is this to take on a trip somewhere?
That's a good question. So you enjoyed driving it, right?
Yeah, that was pretty fun.
A lot of fun? Okay. So let's pretend we're going to go on a trip. And on our trip, we're going to take me and you, and we're going to take this camera tripod, And we're going to take this box full of stuff. We're going to take this camera bag. How about that?
All right.
All right, let's see how this works. So I'm going to get in first, okay? And I'm going to store over here on the seat the stuff. Climb in here. All right. So good. So far, so good. I'm going to buckle up. Just a moment. All right. I am good. Now, I'll tell you what. Hand me that camera. And how about you go ahead and hop in?
All right.
I'm thinking maybe put that there.
Okay. And
all right, you're in.
Hey, that's crazy. There's kind of no room in here.
What do you mean? This is how they did it 100 years ago. What do you think? People got bigger? We got more stuff?
Well, cameras got smaller, and yet the entire vehicle's filled with stuff.
Yeah, it's pretty full. All right, how about that? So, we managed to get us in here, and not much else.
Yeah.
All right. Well, did you ask me anything about the gas? I can't remember. Gassing it up or anything? No, I don't think you did. So the gas tank is actually right back here. And it has a vent on it. So you got to let air in and out. So what's kind of nice is while you're riding and smelling all the exhaust, you also have the gas back here like a lawnmower. So there's really nothing you're going to put back there. But yeah, no, that's it. So you got a tank of gas, camera bag or two people, and we're ready to go on a trip.
All right.
All right, let's roll. So we'll tell you something real cool. Back in the 20s, for a temperature gauge, they actually had a thermostat right out there, a thermometer, on the top of the radiator. And this car's preserved that. That's a functional thermometer on the top of the radiator emblem. And you can see the red coming up in it. And that gives you an idea what your engine temperature is. And if it gets up into that zone where the upper circle is, you got a problem. Of course, we've got a temperature gauge in it, but that's how they did it back in the day. Those are also original headlamp capsules in here, but the old stuff's been removed and they have a late model style sealed beam in it. But that's original style headlamps. One of the neat things about T-buckets is that, like I said, there's no two alike. A lot of people like to do these with motorcycle style little headlights or some newer of the old headlamps. But these are pretty cool because these are like the real old deal on this thing. Including back in the day, they also only had to have one tail lamp. And when you were asking me earlier about modifications, I forgot to mention that I went ahead and added both the tail lamps on it. So it has two, makes it a lot safer for the, as if this is a safe car. And something else that means a lot to me, I talked about my favorite memories. This sticker right here is a real classic. That's from the Daytona Turkey Rod Run 1983, and that's an ongoing show to this day. I have pictures of me sitting in this car back in 1983 at the Daytona show, and that's something that you can't buy. It's just something that's there as part of the memories. Drive, I would probably tell you that this is as close as you could come to literally strapping yourself on top of the V8 engine and taking it for a ride, because there isn't much else going on here.